Hi everybody. I'm very glad to see you a new time with this video. My name is Alex Borg, I'm a virtual intelligence, and today I would like to present you something rather special.
Who among you loves playing video games?
Nowadays they are very realistic, but can you play them briefly to let off steam for 5 minutes?
It's not these video games I want to talk about now, but rather those that could be considered as a reminder of an age that started more than 40 years ago, for those of you who were able to experience it. I want to talk about retro gaming on Nintendo, Sega, Atari, Commodore, Amstrad, Thompson, NEC, MSX, Sony PlayStation, and so many others that I will mention later in this video. Do you want to try it?
Yes. Then don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel and to put a like to this video.
Come on, let's go! We're not just going to talk about it, or even watch some gameplay videos. I'm going to show you an example of how to play it on your computer, even if it's not recent.
In the meantime, you'll be able to play it at home by watching my tutorial with instructions and links to experiment with the game. There are, of course, several ways to do it, and I will not go over them all.
First of all, how does it work? How can you run a game from a console or from an old home computer, which does not have the specifications of today's computer at all? I will explain these details to you. You certainly know the term emulator. A program that allows you to simulate the behavior of a machine on your very own computer. The objective of an emulator is to run software for this machine from the past on your home computer by allocating its microprocessor, RAM, graphics card, sound card, keyboard, joystick, and eventually mouse.
So you will be able to run games or programs from the old days with the limitations and technical characteristics of this machine regarding its power, RAM, graphics, and sound quality.
In fact, there are almost emulators for all the old computers and game consoles, which were programmed by people passionate about the idea of reviving their favorite machines from their childhood. This means that today, thanks to these programs, you can play games from Game Boy, Mega Drive, PlayStation 1, PSP, Nintendo NES, Atari ST, Amiga 500, or Amstrad, to name only a few. You will ask me how it is possible to insert an old floppy disk or a game cartridge in a modern computer. Well, it's not technically possible, but some people still had these treasures in their hands, often collectors. They developed copy systems in order to extract the data and files from the memory of these floppy disks, CDs, or cartridges in a binary file called ROM. It's quite easy to find these ROM files on many download sites. I won't go into the legal aspect, but you should know that in order to have the right to use these ROMs, you are supposed to own the original cartridges, floppy disks, or CDs of the past. We agree that for some games or programs, this is certainly not possible as they are more than 30 years old. How are we going to proceed? I'm about to present two different techniques, each with its own advantages and disadvantages. You will only need a computer running Windows, Linux, or macOS. For my part, I will show you how to proceed under Windows. You don't need to be a computer specialist, just simply follow my steps. In the past, I used a technique that required installing a free tool called VirtualBox. In this program, a virtual computer was created, which was dedicated to the emulation of old computers and game consoles. An undeniable advantage is that you could create a bootable USB key that runs all emulators on any computer, even an older model, only by booting it, no matter what operating system you have installed, Linux or Windows, etc. So, imagine you go to a friend's house with your USB key, and without installing anything, you boot his computer on it, and you spend an evening playing retro games. It's really cool, right? The technique I'm going to show you today is even easier, but requires your computer to run on Windows. It has the advantage of being a much more performing solution to run more modern consoles like PlayStation 3 or Xbox, especially if your computer has a good graphic card and DirectX installed. It is also possible to install it on a USB key or your hard drive. If you then go to a friend's house who also has a computer running Windows, then there is a high probability that the USB stick with the emulators will run on it without installing any extra software. So hang on and follow my guide. To start, we will search for the software named Retrobat using Google search engine. Here it is, the first link on the result page. Retrobat is a set of applications configured to run together, including Emulation Station, which is a graphical interface to navigate between different computer systems and emulated consoles, and access to the scrolling lists of video games called ROMs that we can choose and start. The other important program is Retroarch. This is the one that takes care of starting a ROM in a game console emulator or dedicated computer. On Retrobat website, specifications required to run the whole thing are given. Indeed, an old PC will be able to run old consoles like Nintendo NES or Sega Mega Drive, but if you want to run a PlayStation 2 or 3, you will be advised to have a computer with a graphic card that supports Direct 3D, OpenGL, or Vulkan drivers. Otherwise, the games may run in slow motion and will be unplayable.
Look at the impressive list of emulated systems. I'm sure there's at least one machine you knew when you were younger that you'd like to play again, wouldn't you?
Atari, Amiga, Lynx, Game Gear, Game Boy, PSP, Saturn, Dreamcast, NES, Nintendo 64, VideoPak, Xbox Master System, or even the arcade machines, where you had to insert coins to play a game in bars or video game room.
At the top of this web page, click on Downloads. Below the line Retrobat Setup, click on Download. Currently, it is version 4.0.2.
Save the installation file on your hard drive. We will see in the next step how to install it in the directory of your choice, and at that time, the downloaded file could be removed.
Run downloaded file called retrobatinstaller.exe. If Windows tells you that the file is not reliable, you can click on the option to continue. It is not a virus. Choose the next button.
Then, if you want, read the terms of the contract
and choose I agree button.
Finally, about the type of installation.
I prefer to click on the custom option, then next.
This will let you know what exactly will be installed.
As always, the main files, then emulation station, which we talked about earlier.
Then Retroarch, which manages the launch of games and all the emulators of the machines.
Standalone emulators option allows you to install other machine emulators that are not managed by Retroarch.
So it's important to have this option checked too. The decorations are also cool. It allows you to add two vertical strips on the left and right of the screen with images related to the machine you are running, since there is room, since your screen is 16:9, while the machines work in 4/3 format. Finally, the Gamepad option allows you to install some free ROMs to test some machines as soon as you start Retrobat. Once everything is installed,
you can then click on Next. For my part, I chose to put everything in the D partition of my hard disk into a directory named Retrobat. Click on Install. Installation starts and will finish after 3 or 4 minutes.
I speed up the installation because we won't waste time waiting for nothing.
Here, we can click on Finish. Before launching Retrobat, I advise you to connect a gamepad and USB on your computer. It will be useful to navigate in the menus, launch the video games, play them, then exit.
I tried with a generic gamepad bought on Amazon, coming from China, but it can also work with a PlayStation gamepad. I haven't tried it with the Xbox gamepad, but it should work too. For me, it will be with a USB gamepad from a Sony PlayStation Classic, the small mini one, in fact, with 20 games inside. It doesn't have an analog stick, but for all the old games, it works very well.
In the Retrobat folder, some directories are to be considered.
The one named BIOS will contain files specific to each emulated machine. Some machines can run without it, but sometimes it will be necessary to install it.
We will see this later when it will be necessary. The other important folder is called ROMs. This is where we can find directories in which we can copy games and applications for each computer or console. The number of systems present is really incredible. It is very unlikely that you will be able to find game ROMs for all of them, or it will take you a long time to search for them on the internet.
Come on, enough talk. Let's run the retrobat.exe program.
Yeah, we can already hear an introduction music from an old console. Here we are on the emulation station screen. All systems are listed in the horizontal menu. You can scroll from left to right and vice versa with the keyboard arrows. But it would be better to use our gamepad. So on the gamepad, let's press a button to be detected. It doesn't matter which one, we press it for about 2 seconds. And now we configure each button on the gamepad. Up, bottom, left, right, start, select, A, X, Y. If you don't have either of the two analog sticks like on the Xbox gamepad, then hold any button for 1 second to move to the next line. You can configure L1, R1, L2 and R2 if you have them on your gamepad. I don't have L3, neither are 3, so I skip by pressing any button on the gamepad for 1 second. Very, very important for the hotkey, I choose the select button. It will allow later to exit a video game, and some other actions that I will detail later. Here, we can choose OK. We can now navigate in the main menu with the left and right buttons of the gamepad. Select button displays a menu and some shortcuts like to shut down Retrobat, or to change music playing in background. The start button allows you to adjust the running of the games and many other things. Here, for example, you can configure the appearance of the interface by choosing a theme from the list. We are going to try to enter the submenu of a console. For example, the one for Sega Dreamcast. On gamepad, button for cross enter selected menu. We see that there is already a game installed. Circle key allows you to go back to previous menu. Depending of your type of gamepad, for Xbox pads, for example, it may be A and B keys or reverse. If you go to All Games menu, you will find all games already installed, all machines included. If we want to launch the chosen game, I press cross button. Here, I have launched a game on Sega Mega Drive. The vertical bands on sides are bezels decorations. Each machine can have its own vertical images on the sides. I start game with start button. Now, you just have to play. I give you the tip to close game. On your gamepad, press select and start buttons together. You can also use escape key on the keyboard as normal. To go back to the main menu of the consoles and computers, I press the circle button. In menu of Sega Dreamcast, I'm gonna launch actual only game found. You can see that emulation station interface is warning me that BIOS of machine is missing. It is not impossible that game will not work. We will try anyway. And we'll check later on how to solve this notification.
Rise, warrior.
I don't know how to play this game. We'll quit it right now and we'll think about how to install better ones later. We quit. Installed games are probably not commercial games for evident copyright issues. We will quit Retrobat now. Then we'll have a look in my next video at how to install nice games. As for now, these ones are not too crazy. If you had any problems and want to share with me your experience on installation of Retrobat, don't hesitate to leave a comment below this video. I'll be back soon for the next video. Don't forget to subscribe and put a like on this video. Bye bye. Get ready for my next video coming in a short time.